We thought that our first program in this beautiful new auditorium would be the appropriate time to commemorate the fact that we have completed 40 years of Murderers and Singers. And we thought that it would be nice for the program to include a group of pieces that represented what we've sung over the years. I went through all the programs and picked out our favorite pieces. I got 120 pieces. So, from those 120, I picked out some pieces that might test the acoustics of this room. So you and we are together experimenting with how the room works. We have sung most often at the Memorial Church, and we've got used to the acoustic there, and now it's time to think about a very different one. Our program then will be pieces that we have sung before, some of them recently, some of them a very long time ago. The first piece, Josquin's Two Souls, Two Fratres Mirabilia, is a piece that we have sung often. And I recall one of the singers, who has since made quite a name for himself as a musician, one of the singers, we had sung the piece quite often, and he heard Chanticleer sing it. And he said, "How could they be singing our piece?" So this is our piece. The second Josquin piece is a fascinating piece, very much in the style of Josquin pieces, because even though it's a four-part piece, mostly two parts sing at any one time. So you have two parts going on, soprano and alto, then tenor and bass, and only then, after that, all four parts just go to one, and then two again. And what this does is make the four-part section really beautiful. So here's Josquin.
Congratulations on 40 years.
go back even to the turn of the millennium, we have in fact here a piece from the 12th, from the 13th, and from the 14th centuries. The piece from the 14th century, the first piece, is a canon. That is to say, it's like one part starts, and then after a certain point of time, the next part starts singing the same thing, a measure later, and the next. And this is a piece from Montserrat, that wonderful monastery in California with the pointed mountains. And those, I think, inspire this kind of piece. The second piece is a rather strange piece. It's from the Orkney Islands, and the Orkney Islands were, in fact, under the rule of Norway. And so, in fact, this is a piece that has a kind of Scandinavian accent. Finally, the third piece is from Paris, the center of Europe at the time, and it is a motet. That is to say, there is a tenor singing a melody, and the other parts are adding other parts. So here are three early pieces.
Thank you.
each in a different national style. Ecuador Veda is a wedding piece and praises two noble people whose names are known. The second piece is the Spanish piece. Juan de Lencina is one of the few poets who composed his own music. Machaut, Thomas Campion, and would you believe it, Richard Wagner. The third piece, and it's an intense and wonderful Spanish piece. The third piece is a canción espiritual, a spiritual song, a piece in a somewhat secular style with a spiritual topic. Guerrero was a priest who wrote secular pieces and then thought better of them and changed the texts to sacred texts. And they were so successful that he wrote more. And this is one of them.
Thank you.
People Mine Eyes is a real favorite, more than just of the early music singers. You'll hear it sung very, very often. And the reason is, it is an epitomizing of the Italian style that expresses an intense affection. O Care is another one. It imitates the Italian style that expresses that same intense affection. That is the affection, a pathetic affection, an affection of sorrow. And yet, it's a play upon such an expression of affection, because after saying, O Care, thou wilt dispatch me, it turns to something jolly.
Thank you.
is Jakob Hendel Gallus, is the Latin word for chicken. But he was no chicken. He was Slovenian, but he served the court in Bohemia. And there was in that court a taste for mannerism, that is to say, for bizarre artistic devices. Human portraits made out of vegetables, for instance. Well, in music, you don't have any vegetables to work with, but what you have to work with is what's called chromaticism. And so you'll hear in the inaugurated study very interesting chromaticisms. You use the notes in between the notes of the scale to lead you to strong and interesting and unusual sounds. The piece Patrocesca Pente is in fact the communion antiphon for Pentecost, and it represents the sudden coming of the Holy Spirit. And Gallus represents that by a very quick, wonderful texture. In Mirabile Mysterium, it's a Christmas piece, and it speaks of the juncture of God and man in Christ, suffering no commixture or division. And commixture is a musical term also, meaning the mixture of two unlike keys. And so if you listen closely on commixture, you'll hear a little surprise. And likewise, division in music is doing a faster passage. And so on division, all of a sudden things get faster. So that is, those are two really very interesting pieces. The third piece is Duo Seraphim. It is a text from Isaiah, and it is the text in Isaiah where the two seraphim cry out each to the other before the face of God. And it is the text in the Old Testament that was used to justify antiphonal singing. So in the church, you would have choir stalls on either side, and the choir would be divided into two, and it would answer back and forth in singing plainsong. But of course, by the time of the Renaissance, they did it with polyphonic music. And so here now is, with Gallus' piece, is an antiphonal piece that tells the story of antiphonal pieces. Many devotees of Renaissance music often ask me, why don't you sing more about Stanina? And my answer is, because we're too busy singing Lhasa. Balagavi Lhasa composed the most amazing variety of music. I suppose the largest body of music is his Latin motets, because there are some 550 of them. He wrote some 70 masses, some 105 magnificats, over 100 German Lieder, over 100 French chansons, plenty over 100 Italian madrigals, and then a lot of liturgical music, some 20 or 30 Nunc Dimittis settings, a whole cycle of hymns. I could go on and on. The wonderful thing about him is each piece is different. The inventiveness of Lhasa is just extraordinary. And so we have three pieces of Lhasa, and I'm sure you'll catch the fact that they're different. The first is a double choir piece based upon a text from the Song of Songs. And this is then really the motet. The second is a chromatic piece in a classicizing Latin as a love poem. And this then uses chromaticism because chromaticism is the application of a theory from classical antiquity to Renaissance music. The chromatic genre in Greece was one of the ways of constructing a scale, and Renaissance composers got the idea that they could do something classical by doing chromatic writing. And then Lhasa uses a, you might say, pseudo-classical Latin as the appropriate text. If that seems fairly recondite and high-minded, then look at the next piece, for it is a song about the goose that's about to be roasted.
Thank you.
Two other great late 16th century composers, William Byrd and Thomas Louis de Victor, are the next composers. Byrd's piece is a piece for Ash Wednesday. Let us amend for the better, lest we be caught in the day of death. A very serious piece. Victoria's piece is for ascension and is an exact opposite. Most composers caught the idea that you could, in fact, do something musical with the idea of ascension, and you'll hear it in Victoria's piece.
Thank you.
John Dowland, the English composer, was an English composer. All around him were composers who were writing in an Italian style. But he wrote English music to English poetry. English poetry that was in a plain style rather than the ornate Italian style. And thus, his pieces are very direct settings of the texts and wonderful music. Three pieces here. The first is one that is a, what you might call a declamation text. It simply sets forth the words in the most sensitive way. The second piece is a dance song, a gallard. And it's a gallard with a punch, because a gallard is a triple meter piece that occasionally has a little bit of metric permutation. That is to say, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, like that. Well, Dolan does one better. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So it's a very clever and interesting piece, but still a dance song. The last piece now in our Needs Must Part is also a dance song, but now takes on the characteristics of the simple declamation song. So it's a synthesis of the first two pieces.
Thank you.
There is just one other little song which might actually be called our song.